Good afternoon. A political divide over the war in the Middle East has widened this afternoon. The Prime Minister today moving a motion to condemn the October 7 attacks on Israel, paying tribute to every single innocent life lost. The opposition refusing to support it. Amanda Kopp has the details.
Well, this is really a demonstration that the political rift is growing over October 7 and the ongoing conflict in Gaza. In just the last few hours, the Prime Minister moved a motion in the House of Representatives unequivocally condemning the attacks on Israel by the listed terrorist group Hamas. Anthony Albanese acknowledging the pain and fear in the Jewish community, labelling the events of October 7 as atrocities and reaffirming Israel's right to defend itself. He also reiterated his government's calls for a ceasefire, the release of hostages, and a peaceful solution to the conflict.
As we mourn and reflect, we also reaffirm a fundamental principle of our shared humanity, that every innocent life matters. Every Israeli, every Palestinian, every Lebanese.
But the opposition would not support that motion, saying it went beyond the focus of the attack on Jewish people. Peter Dutton standing up in the House to accuse the Prime Minister of trying to walk both sides of the street.
There has been a position of bipartisanship on these issues, and your predecessors would have had the decency to respect the Jewish community in a way that you have not done today. And for that, Prime Minister, you should stand condemned.
So just a day after commemorations were held to mark the first anniversary of October 7, the Parliament hasn't been able to reach a statement of unity. And that really reflects the broader divisions in society around this ongoing conflict.
Australians fleeing Lebanon are this afternoon back home, the first rescue flight touching down at the airport. Their families waiting with open arms for those who've escaped the war-torn region with mixed emotions.
A warm welcome home. More than 340 Australians of all ages happy to be here after a long journey out of the Middle East.
I just want to say thank you, Australia. You got us back home safe. We're very heartbroken. We're very exhausted after 3 days non-sleep. But at least now I know my kids are safe.
I'm very happy. I'm actually over the moon right now. I haven't seen him in a long time and I'm very happy. I was really scared. It was the first time we experienced this in Lebanon. We lived in Australia all of our life.
Family and friends keen to greet their loved ones, bringing balloons and flowers to the terminal. Some aboard the Mercy flight feared they wouldn't make it out of the war-torn region.
Every day I was there, I was thinking if I'd make it. Yeah. Thanks God. Thanks God.
There was a sense of sadness for those leaving Lebanon, knowing that they are leaving loved ones behind.
It was very heart-touching as I left my family there. But at least we are here safe.
Just relieved. I'm so sorry for whoever can't make it back.
Tonight, similar scenes are expected here at Sydney Airport as a Qatar Airways and Qantas flight brings back hundreds of people. A special charter flight is also en route, arriving in Brisbane early tomorrow morning, while another Qantas service is also scheduled for the coming days. But with more than 3,000 Australians wanting to leave Lebanon, many are still stuck in the region with limited options out. Jack Hahn, Nine News.
Well, there has been quick condemnation of a speaker at a pro-Palestinian vigil at Lakemba on Monday night who described October 7 as a good day. The federal government now reportedly reviewing the visa status of Khaled Beyroun, an associate professor at Arizona State University.
Today is not fully a day of mourning. In many respects, today is also a day that marks considerable celebration, considerable progress, and in some respects, considerable privilege.
His comments have been condemned by Jewish leaders as incitement. Israel has marked the first anniversary of the October 7 attack as the conflict in the Middle East intensifies. Memorial services have been held under heightened security, with Israel and Hezbollah trading new rocket strikes. Edward Godfrey is in Tel Aviv.
Today was expected to be a day of heightened hostilities, and that has been the case. The most severe blows coming from the Israeli Defence Force in Lebanon, conducting what they've called extensive strikes Beirut was targeted once again, as well as the country's south. Hezbollah has fired rockets in return across the border, taking aim at the northern Israeli city of Haifa, 10 people injured in blasts there. Tensions have flared inside the West Bank today. A 12-year-old boy was shot by Israeli forces during a clash between soldiers and local youths. The 12-year-old dying of his wounds. That all came about as the army raided a camp then on the outskirts of Jerusalem, arresting 22 people. Today has seen commemorations right across the country, marking 1 year since the October 7th attacks. A day and the events that have followed have changed the Middle East forever. One of the main events was in Israel south at Reim, the site of the Supernova Music Festival, where 364 people lost their lives and 44 people were taken hostage. Here in Tel Aviv, there's been a ceremony for the families of the hostages inside Gaza, 101 still unaccounted for. We've met a woman named Herit Nimrodi. Her 18-year-old son was kidnapped from near the Gaza border on October 7, and she spoke with us.
My son was 18 years old when he was brutally abducted from the Gaza border. He was part of COGAT, which ironically gives humanitarian aid for the Palestinians in Gaza. So he was his base was on the border.
Up to 40,000 people were originally going to be attending tonight's event, but due to the higher risk of attacks, the IDF has put a limit on the number of people who can gather together, capping it at 2,000. There have been some very emotional stories from this event here. There is a table set with places for all of the 101 hostages. On the screen behind us, you can see that unmistakable bright red clock there, counting the days, minutes, hours and seconds since they've been missing. A lot of suffering going on right across the region amid this war, which is being fought on multiple fronts.
The incredible World Heritage Site of Machu Picchu is one of the seven wonders of the world, and it's on the bucket list for many Aussies. And now you can tour the site from right here in Sydney. It's part of an exhibition opening at the Australian Museum where 134 priceless Peruvian artefacts will be on display, including the largest collection of gold to ever leave Peru. Kim McKay is the CEO of the Australian Museum and she joins us now. Kim, tell us more.
Yes, it is, Davina. This is exclusive to the Australian Museum in Sydney, and it's a true blockbuster event because, as you said, Machu Picchu and the Golden Empires of Peru are on people's bucket list to visit and find out about. You know, we always think of Peruvian culture as being the Inca culture, which was the last before the Spanish conquistadors arrived. But in fact, Peruvian culture dates back well over 3,000 years that are covered in this exhibition. So at the same time as Egyptian civilization was really developing, so too was this amazing series of cultures in Latin America really emerging. And they were very sophisticated. They had a lot of gold and silver, amazing jewelry, incredible pottery, which told stories of their empires, but also set against the Andean backdrop. And of course, Machu Picchu is an extraordinary city on the top of the mountain. And, you know, I have been there, I can say, three times now, and working down there with archaeologists. And it really does take your breath away. But so does our virtual reality experience, apart from the exhibition that goes alongside this. In fact, I was sitting in the chair watching it with the headset on, and I thought I was flying off the top of Machu Picchu. You actually fly off the top of it with one of the Incan gods, the condor, god of the condor. And so it gives you this extraordinary bird's eye view, literally, of Machu Picchu.
It sounds like it's an extraordinary blend of the old culture and new technology, and you're saying it's almost better than the real thing?
Well, I think a lot of people can't necessarily make the plan to walk to Machu Picchu. You go on a train to the top of it, but this will certainly have you experience that. And I think after people have come to the Australian Museum to see the exhibition and to experience the virtual reality, they'll want to go as well.
So when will people be able to come visit?
We open on Saturday, the 23rd of November, until the end of April. And during that time, you can, in fact, tickets went on sale today. So people can book online right now and ensure that they, you know, can work around the holiday periods and plan to come to the Australian Museum. We've got a lot of activities on during that time. We'll be having a Peruvian cultural festival as well, and lots of food and those pisco sour drinks too, which are pretty good.
It sounds extraordinary. I'm in. Thank you so much for your time and congratulations.
Thank you, Davina.